my life song sing to you.
Let my life song sing.
Let my life song sing to you.
Jesus, let my life song sing.
I wanna sign your name. End of this day, knowing that my heart was true. So let my life song sing to you. Oh, we wanna sing to you, Jesus.
Here I am, Lord, and I'm drowning in your sea of forgetfulness. The chains of yesterday surround me. I yearn for peace and rest. I don't want to end up where you found me. And it echoes in my mind, keeps me awake tonight. Cast my sin as far.
Good morning. We are so happy that you are with us this morning and glad that you made it today. We are here to learn and to worship our God, and we just pray that you would be able to do that with us today. A couple of announcements. The first one is in the seat rack in front of you, there should be a blue card. If you can look and pick it up. Everybody look for the blue cards in front of you and pick them up. So these are your ways to communicate with us. You can make a comment on, do not make a comment on there, but if you have any questions, you are free to do that. Ask your questions if it's about the sermon, if it's about the worship service, if it's about what's taking place in our church. If you are new to us, this is a great way for us to get your information to communicate with you. We do have a newsletter that goes out twice monthly, so if you fill out this card or scan the QR code, we can get that information to you where all the announcements will be, not just the ones that we shared today. The next thing is we will be having a membership class next Sunday at 9 a.m. In room 16. If you are 16 years and above, you are able to attend the membership class and become a member here at Stow Alliance. So if that's an option for you at this time, please feel free to attend that class next Sunday. Then we also have step one coming at the end of this month on April 28th. This is just the building blocks of our church, the who, the why, the why we do what we do, where you can get involved. It's just a chance for you to take a class to learn all of that. I think that's it for now. I'm going to turn it over to Dawn, and you guys are going to have a wonderful experience this morning between learning and worshiping Jesus.
Good morning. All right, we're warming up. We're getting there today. Would you stand this morning? I am just so incredibly excited to be able to praise and worship the Lord together through song, through music. I just want to encourage you, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So whatever your expression of praise to the Father looks like, be free in that. You can sit, you can listen, you can stand, you can sing, you can spend some time at the altar. Whatever that looks like, God is pleased with our sacrifice of praise. And that's the phrase that's been coming to mind as I've been preparing my heart for today. Maybe you're coming in here and you're in a great place and you're excited and you're ready. And so a sacrifice of praise doesn't feel that hard. And maybe you're coming in and you're struggling and you're in the middle of a battle. And we're going to sing about that a lot this morning. And so I just want to encourage you, whatever your sacrifice of praise looks like, just give it 100% to the Lord. He deserves the honor. He deserves the praise. He deserves the glory. And so we're going to fix our eyes on him. We are going to bless him this morning because he deserves it.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name.
Can you just, between you and the Lord this morning, begin to bless him, begin to praise him in your own words? It doesn't have to be loud. Father, you are worthy. You are holy. We honor you in this place. Whether you give or take away, Lord, those are hard words. Those are hard words to sing. We sing, blessed be your name. But Lord, we trust you. We know that you are faithful. We know that you are always working. Thank you, Jesus.
Nothing can stand against
as we sing these next couple songs, I just want to encourage you to wrestle with the words. It's okay if not everything that's on the screen is something that you feel confident about. You feel like you could sing and mean it. It's hard to get our eyes off of our stuff, off of the battle, especially when we're in the middle of it, and fix our eyes on our almighty fortress. So whatever it is you carried into this room, I'm going to encourage you as we sing, as we praise, as we surrender, we let the Holy Spirit speak to you. The Holy Spirit wants to speak to all of us, but he wants to speak to you about the battle you're facing, about the storm that you're in. And if you're not in a storm, I just encourage you to pray for those around you that are, because many of us are. But whether you're feeling the words of the song or not, it's still truth. That's why we praise. We're fixing our eyes on the truth. We're fixing our eyes on Christ.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. But you have never failed me yet. Jesus, we trust you. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me.
Promise still stands.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never. The night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again.
Jesus, you're still enough.
Jesus, you're still enough. Great is your faithfulness. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence.
You've never. So your promise still stands.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. You never failed me yet. I never will forget. You never failed me yet. I never.
Faithful Lord, you are good. Lord, help us to trust.
You call me out. Great unknown, we may fail. There I find you in the mystery, in ocean's deep. My faith will stand.
I will call.
And I will call upon your name. Keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine. Abounds in deepest waves.
practice our prayer this morning.
Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith will be made stronger. Presence of
Spirit,
my
lead
Savior.
Me.
Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith will be made stronger. The presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith will be made stronger. In the presence of my Savior.
And I will call upon your name. And keep my eyes above waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look for lift our voices, turn your eyes.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strange. In the light of his glory and grace,
and the things of earth,
and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
In the house of the Lord this morning. You may be seated. We encourage you to give cheerfully to the church. And while we don't pass the plate around, there are many opportunities for you to give. There are offering boxes in the back. Give at the office or especially give online. We encourage you to do so and appreciate giving back that which belongs to you. 1 Corinthians 11:23-26 says, the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread, drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. He says, do this in remembrance of me. The Lord's Supper or communion is a significant way that we are called to remember Christ and his gospel work. Do this to remember Jesus. He said, do this in remembrance of me. to remember his incarnation, said, "This is my body." To remember his death, said, "This is my blood." To remember the new community he created, he said, "Drink of it, all of you." To remember the forgiveness of sin, said, "This is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." It is to remember his mission. Communion is a great chance for the church to refocus on the mission Christ gave to us. When he shed his blood, it was for the world. And to remember the new covenant, this cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. To remember the love of God, which is for you. This one is obvious. Just holding the bread and the cup in your hands makes one feel the love of God. Jesus came. He came because of the love which flowed from his heart. And to remember the hope of Christ's return. For as often as you drink, as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's commune and remember. The elders come. Receive the elements.
As you make your way down, you can come. As you make your way down, I just encourage you to allow this song to help you prepare your heart. You can sing, you can listen, you can pray.
And all these pieces, broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole. Empty-handed, but not forsaken.
so grateful, thankful that just 10 days ago, your body was broken. May we live. Your blood was poured out for us. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. So we thank you that you came plainly to us. We can be forgiven and clothed in Jesus. Bless us this day.
Stand and sing that chorus with me. Amazing grace.
Let's pray together. Jesus, we thank you today for the reminder of your sacrifice. That you did that to bring us to God. So today, Jesus, we ask you to speak. We need you to speak. Would you speak to us from your word today and give us courage to live it out. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you can have a seat, church. Good morning, church. All right, y'all survived Easter. That's kind of like a mixed laughter when we say that, right? Like, yeah, I don't know. Like, but I'm so glad that you guys are here today. I'm so glad we get a chance to talk after Easter, because Easter is such a huge thing, and we've got a lot of things that happen. A lot of people come to church that don't normally come to church, and then we're never really sure what happens after that. And so I'm really glad that you guys are here. I'm thankful that we get a chance to spend some time together today. If you're a guest with us, I want to welcome you here. We're going to be in the book of 1 Peter here in a few minutes. So just letting you know where that is. And if I haven't got a chance to meet you yet, I'd love to meet you before you head out today. So post-Easter, now that Easter's over, we're 1 week past it. This last week, I was spending some time listening to some things on discipleship and disciple-making, which is really important for us as a church, because that's the mission of our church, is to turn ordinary people into fearless, world-changing disciple-makers. That's the mission Jesus gave the church. That's the mission that the church will always have until he comes back. And so it's important for us to refresh that and to look at that. But as I was looking at some of the things that were written about discipleship and some things I was listening to, there was a statement that was made that just struck me. And I wanted to share it with you, because I want to see how this statement lands for you. So this is the statement. Is that Christians are succeeding at things that are pushing people away from Jesus. How's that sit with you? Right? It probably depends on who you ask, right? But there are some of us say, like I shared that with somebody today, and they were like, absolutely. Like, it wasn't even a pause. But there are things that Christians do that we're good at. And sometimes those things actually push people away from coming to know Jesus. And so when you look at Gen Z, that's like they're not the youngest generation alive. That's Gen Alpha that's coming after them. But Gen Z is sort of coming into their own right now, and they're doing a lot of research on faith in that generation. 34% of Gen Z says that they're atheist, agnostic, or non-religious. 40% of that generation says they're spiritual but not religious. They're the largest unchurched generation in the history of the world. Right? Like right now. Like those are some hard things to look at. And when you kind of pan out from them and you look at some things other people think about the church, these are some stats you can find. But 9 out of 10 say the American church is too what? Ooh, that's a hard one. Right? 9 out of 10 people think we're judgmental. 85% describe the church as hypocritical. 1/3 say it's characterized by moral failures in leadership. And 70% found the church to be insensitive to others. Like those are some hard things to look at, right, when you hear that? Because that's not just somebody making up some stuff. That's somebody that did some research, and they got some answers. And obviously, polls are skewed and those kinds of things. But that's some things to think about. That's some things to think about, especially in the times in which we live, because we talked about this many times. But we live in incoherent times. Like rational thought just seems to have gone out the window. And whatever you wake up on any given morning and you feel, that just determines your reality for today. That's the way our culture is being taught. Like we're so connected digitally, but so isolated in real relationships. We've been substituting digital for real for a long time. When you look at church metrics, like evangelism and reaching lost people is on a serious nosedive. We found that, you know, when COVID happened, that the methods of discipleship that we thought we were practicing and doing well at, we thought they were doing really good, and then COVID happened, and we found out they were really anemic and really weak, and they weren't doing what we thought they were doing. And so we pivoted to focus a lot on that, and then COVID went away, or so to speak, right? Sort of gone back to the norm. And then we all went back to the normal things that we were doing before, and we forgot about discipleship again. They're studying all this stuff out, and we find a lot of Christians are stuck. They feel paralyzed. Some have gone to one extreme, and they're just completely retreating from the culture. And then some have gone to the other extreme. I call them digital screamers. Like they're the ones raging at everybody online. Right? They're just yelling all the time, being so mad about what's going on. And in looking at all this stuff, they said this. They said, if you're married to your methods of the old, you could soon find yourself divorced from having a church. Like those are some strong things to think about when it comes to the nature of discipleship and in all these incoherent times. And we live in a time right now where the largest part of our culture, they're actually craving authenticity and relationship. They actually want that. It's so big. And we find this too when you study it out, that 82% of people would be open to coming to church if a friend invited them. But only 2% of Christians ask. That's a challenging stat, isn't it? Like people long for relationship. They're craving it. They want it. We could give it to them, but they don't get invited. And then the culture just goes crazy, and it's all just spiraling. And it feels like this crazy, perfect storm that's happening right now. So how are we supposed to help people who are far from God come close to God? And you start to look at the state of things, and you say, well, who's going to stand up and lead in the moment right now? Who's going to do it? Like, who do you think should be leading right now? Like, how would you answer that question? So think about that. How would you answer the question? Who should be leading in these times right now? How do you think God would answer that question? Who should be leading when times are incoherent, when things are in chaos? You know what God's answer is? It's the church. The church. That's our place. When you read the New Testament, that's our place in the world. It's to be a pillar of truth. To stand the ground when culture goes crazy. So here's what I want you to know. No one else can be church for us. No one else can do the unique part in church that God created you to do. Sure, we can find somebody else that might be able to do what you could do, but they're not you. You were made. You were here on purpose as part of the church for times like this. God knew the time and the place in which you would live, and he chose you for now. So who should be leading in these days? The church. That's God's answer. That's going to be his answer until he comes back. So what would it look like If we stopped succeeding at things that were driving people away from Jesus, and we started succeeding at things that were helping people find God, that would bring some joy and some delight to God's heart. I think that would be the same for us, because wouldn't that be amazing? Like all of those numbers, if you could flip them, that 9 out of 10 people say the church is known for being amazing instead of judgmental. Imagine if we were the people that flipped that. That's exactly what we're going to talk about today. How do you do that? Because you can see the problem, right? We're not really known for being much like Jesus these days. But that can change. So we're going to be in the book of 1 Peter. It's a little letter that Peter wrote to the church, to a region of church people. This is not just somebody writing some good advice. This is the Apostle Peter. This is an eyewitness of Jesus Christ, who walked with him, who talked with him, who saw the crucifixion, who saw the empty tomb, who even denied that he knew Jesus right before he was crucified and then was reinstated to the ministry by Jesus himself after he was raised from the dead. Like this is not just some random person. This is a very specific person who was an eyewitness in the first century of Jesus. So we've been studying this. We're picking it up in chapter 4 today. We're going to go back and look at the last two verses we looked at last week as the first two verses for this week. And so I'm just going to walk you through this passage, and then we'll try to apply it at the end. So here's what Peter says. Since therefore, okay, therefore, right? Bible tip. Anytime, this is, I know this sounds so cheesy. Anytime you see a therefore, you need to know what it's there for. Okay, good. So since therefore, okay, what's therefore? All right, that's all the first three chapters of Peter. Now, Peter didn't write this in verse chapter form. He just wrote one long letter. But everything he's been saying up to this point, he's saying because of all of that, because all that Jesus has done, because of all the things that he accomplished on the cross, because of the suffering that you go through as a Christian, keep all of that in your mind. Since therefore, Christ suffered. And that's everything we celebrated last week on Easter. That he went to the cross, that he conquered death, because Jesus has done all of those things, because Christ suffered in the flesh. Therefore, he says, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. Now, when you see this, you think, like arm yourself. Well, you might think about, like, well, let's go strap on the guns and the bulletproof vest and the boots and the headgear and the headlamps, and let's just get loaded down with the weaponry. That's not what Peter means. It's similar in the way you'd get prepared for battle, but he's saying, get prepared upstairs. Get prepared up here. So because Christ suffered, arm yourself with the same mindset. Arm yourself with that same view in mind. That yes, Christ suffered, so as a Christian, you're probably going to suffer too. So just lock that into your mind. Since Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. It's get prepared for battle mentally. Be alert. Be paying attention. And I know when we start talking about that falls into the realm of suffering. I'm going to apologize for the crassness of the word up front. But this kind of, to me, it screams the mindsets you might hear from a military person when they say, you know what, when things are hard out there, just embrace the suck. There's a part of some of this that's not always the easiest thing in the world to do. But Peter's saying, as a Christian, just embrace it in your mind. Get ready for it. Be prepared. Be thinking like Jesus would think. So make sure that your perspectives and your expectations are lining up with those of Jesus. Make sure you're beginning to see the world the way Jesus sees the world. So Peter begins this chapter by saying, this is all about picking up your cross and denying yourself and following Jesus. So tune in with your mind on this. Because Christ suffered, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. And this gets a little harder when he says this, but he says, whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. Now, that's a challenging one, right? When you think, well, if I suffer in my flesh a little bit, then I've stopped sinning. I must be perfect. That's not what Peter's saying. Right? When he says you cease from sin, that means you're not giving it the power in your life. It means you've hit the pause button on it. Like you've chosen to do something else intentionally. So it's not just, well, I'm having a hard day today, so I guess that means I don't have any sin. He's not saying that. He's just saying, don't live the rest of your life excusing it. Don't live the rest of your life thinking that sin's normal and it's totally okay. He says, resist it. He told us earlier in the letter to cut it out, to remove it. Now, that doesn't mean that you're going to never have another sin or never have an issue. The odds of you sinning before the day is pretty high. Okay, you're a human being. Like, you're not perfect. That's why we need a Savior. That's why we need help. But Peter is telling you, get your mindset right. Arm yourselves with the same way of thinking so that you don't go down the path of sin, that you actively resist that in your life. Because for the rest of the time that you have, until you die, however long that is, he says, make sure you're living that for the will of God and not whatever your flesh wants. So Peter's not mincing words here, is he? Like, I'm just telling you what he said. And it already feels like heavy, doesn't it? But here you go. It's going to get heavier. So how do you do that? How do you live the rest of your life for the will of God? Well, in the next 9 verses, Peter is going to contrast two things. He's going to contrast an extreme view of what it looks like to live without God and a healthy view of what it looks like to live life with God. And he's going to unpack those two. I'm going to be honest with you. I don't really want to preach this. Like when you start digging into these passages, it's heavy. It's serious stuff. It's weighty. And it would be so easy for us just to skip it and just find something more encouraging and more happy on the Sunday after Easter, right? When you start looking into Peter's words, though, that's why I said when we study books of the Bible, we don't skip passages because we want to deal with what's really in the Word of God. And so right after Peter delivers that gospel message at the end of chapter 3, he starts talking about how to live your life for the will of God. And he gives us a contrast of what it's like to live without God and what it's like to live with God. So we're going to look at life without God first. So here's what he says. For the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do. Okay, anybody know who the Gentiles are? You. Me. Everybody that's non-Jewish descent, scripturally, will be a Gentile. Okay? In this context, too, it's those who aren't Jewish and those who don't know God, that don't do the things that God would want to do. So what you could kind of translate this out is Peter's telling you what it's like to be lost, to not have God, and to not know the ways of God. And he's calling that Gentiles in this. And so he says, the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do. Because this is how Gentiles live. They live in sensuality, in passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. And with respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they malign you. That's a lot of stuff, isn't it? So let's pull those out real quick. This is what he says life as a Gentile is pretty much characterized by. Now, I know if you're not a Christian, this may not be the extreme that you're at, but it's there. It's out there. You see this in our culture, don't you? Like this is written almost 2,000 years ago, and it's stunning how spot on it is for today. Like, you see this stuff, don't you? And you look at that list, you say, well, that's almost a 2,000-year-old list. And you can look at that and be like, you know what? Not much has changed in regards to people in the last 2 millennia. Basically, life without God equates down to drink, have sex, and live wildly. There are entire organizations and institutions that are alive today because of the demand for these kinds of things. And a demand to try to erase or remove the consequences that we incur from doing those kinds of things. You see it. Peter says, that's what it's like. That's what it's like without God. And to some degree, you might say, well, that's maybe the best that you can get. Because if you don't believe in anything beyond this life, Solomon said, just eat, drink, and be merry, because tomorrow you die and it doesn't matter. Like, that's the mindset behind that. That's a way of doing life without God. Just do whatever you want. Right now, I don't know if you ever used the word debauchery. Right? I don't know if that's a common word that you have, you know, I'm just feeling debaucherous today. Right? You probably don't do that, but that word basically it's tied to the parable of the prodigal son. In the way he took what he had and he went and he squandered it with wild living and he wrecked his life and ends up having nothing left. That's all summed up in that word debauchery. It's just the careless, reckless way of living, just doing whatever my flesh wants, whenever it wants, and it just spirals out of control. And that's the sum total of all of those things. And Peter says, they're surprised Like when you as a Christian, when you don't do those things, they're surprised that you don't do them. Like how can you not do the crazy stuff that I do on the weekend? How could you not do those crazy things? Like you're the weirdo, not me. And it says they're surprised by it and they malign you. That's another word you don't use every day, right? I don't think any of you have come home from work in the last month and said, you know what, I felt really maligned at work today. Right? But maligning here is to purposely hurt your reputation. It's to make false accusations and to slander and to share evil words about somebody. So they're surprised when you don't do all of the drinking and wild things. And they tear you down for it. I started looking at that a little bit more and I started thinking about that. I want to ask this question. Is the world surprised anymore? Because when you dig into church statistics and the things that they study out, a lot of the same things on that list you'll find in the church. It's really sad. I actually once heard of a church, they spend 50% of their church budget on alcohol to try to reach lost people. That's crazy. A church funding drinking parties to save people. It's wild. And you start thinking about all the sexual sin that's out there. This is so hard for us in our culture, but I just want you to hear this. 94% of children will see porn by the age of 18. 94% of our kids. That's crazy. They studied out young Christian adults, 18 to 24. This is what they found. 76% of the 18 to 24-year-old Christians actively look for pornography. 76%! Are they surprised anymore? I'm not so sure. When we talk about divorce rates, right? We used to talk about, you know, divorce in the church is just like it is in the world. We're getting better there. It's gone down to 20 to 33% in the church. But since COVID, the church is also half the size it was before COVID. Are they surprised anymore? That lawless idolatry, like they've studied this out. What are the top five idols in church? Comfort, control, money, approval, and success. Peter says they're surprised when you don't do this. When you look at the reality of things, I'm not sure they're surprised anymore. Now, I'd be really, you know, we could make a new legalistic standard and we could draw a line and say, nope, you can't do that. You can't be in church if you do those things. But the reality is if we're really going after reaching the 93,000 plus lost people in our communities, we should expect that there are people in the room every time dealing with those things. It's not going to go away. It's not going to be hidden. We're not going to either go to the other extreme either and say, you know what, we're just going to condone everybody's sin because we want to be relevant. Like there has to be a way of looking at that and working that through. And you know, St. Augustine said it this way, but he said, the church is not a museum for saints. It's a hospital for sinners. There needs to be a way to reach lost people dealing with those things, where they find some safety and they find some care and they find a way to not keep doing those things. But they're not going to find that if the Christians keep doing the same things that the world does. We've got to get back to being surprising and letting those things go. So Peter continues on here. So where's God in all of this? And we talk about non-Christians. He says the Gentiles will give an account to God, who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this is why the gospel was preached, even to those who are dead, that though judged in the flesh the way people are, they might live in the spirit the way God does. Now, let me just take a quick aside. This passage is confusing because of the word dead. Okay, Peter's using two different types of dead here. I know that sounds really crazy, right? Like, there's only one kind of dead. Well, not really. Okay, so the first dead is the actual physical dead. Like the people that are already deceased and are gone, Peter is reminding us that they're going to stand before God at the resurrection and God is going to judge them. So the gospel is then preached to the spiritually dead, those who are not born again yet, those who have not believed in the gospel. So there's the real dead and the metaphorical dead that he's talking about in this passage. So with that in mind, he's saying there's going to be a judgment. You are going to stand before God one day and he will judge you. And if you go back to the way we looked at this in the beginning of Peter's letter, he says that God is a judge who judges. Anybody remember the word? Impartially, right? There's no way that you're going to get to heaven and God's going to be like, you know what, you were my favorite human. You get a free one, right? He's not going to do that. Like, he's going to judge fairly and impartially. It will always be right and it will always be holy. And because of that, he's saying, preach the gospel. Tell them about Jesus. Because in light of that judgment, you have a choice in front of you. Are you going to live for the fear of man or for the fear of God? The pleasure of the flesh or the will of the Spirit? That choice is in front of you every single day for the rest of your life. Will you live it for what other people will think or what God thinks? Because even right now, like, odds of you suffering as a Christian are pretty high. Like, people are going to reject that. They're going to put you on the spot and be like, how can you believe what you believe, you crazy Christian? And they're going to say things like that. But listen, don't let that rattle you, because when they stand before God, the script flips. They're going to be put on the spot for their unbelief, not you. So pay attention to this as you go through life. You have a choice to make. Will you live for God or will you live for the flesh? So that's a picture of what it's like to live life without God. Now, what does Peter say about living life with God? So, the end of all things is at hand. Woo! You end timers are really relishing this one right now, right? Okay, but I gotta kind of put a needle in that balloon. Peter's not talking about the end times. He's not talking about Left Behind. He's not talking about the eclipse that's going over all the cities named Nineveh. Okay? He's just saying the goal is clear. End here means goal. It's the same word Jesus used when he says the kingdom of God is at hand. Like, the kingdom of God is a real thing. The goal of what we're supposed to do as Christians is to live the rest of our lives for the will of God. That's so clear. You know the end in advance. You know what's in front of you. The goal is laid out for you. So live that out. That's what he's saying. And we get our second therefore. So because the goal is clear, I want you to hear all of this, and then we're going to walk back through it. He says, because the goal is clear, therefore be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers. Above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins. Show hospitality to one another without grumbling. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks is one who speaks oracles of God. Whoever serves is one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Say it with me. Amen. Right? So we're going to walk back through that. So if you're going to sum all of that up into one word, it would be this: engage. It's Peter's command to the church. Engage. Don't hide away. Don't sit back. Don't be passive. Don't just rest on the success of the past, but rather engage. Be active. Be intentional. Put feet to your faith. Do something with what you've been given. Peter's laying that out for the church, and he gives very clear specifics about how to do that in this passage. He says, be self-controlled and be sober-minded. Where does self-control come from? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's working that in you so that you have some self-control and you don't just mindlessly give in to the things of your flesh. And he's talking about being sober-minded, which means being in your right mind. And when we think sober, we think about not drinking. And this isn't Peter saying never have a drink or anything like that. This is about Peter saying keep your head on straight, so that you're to arm yourself with the same way of thinking. You do that by being self-controlled and sober-minded. So try to picture, like if any of you are sports fans, like maybe you'll see a player that goes out and they make some really stupid mistake or penalty, and then the coach pulls them off the field. You remember what the coach says when they come off the field? He points at him, he says, get your head in the game! Right? If it's a football player, they might grab the face mask. He's like, what are you doing? Get your head in the game! Right? And all you High School Musical fans will know that one, right? This is what Peter's saying. Be self-controlled. Be sober-minded. Arm yourself with the same way of thinking. This is all cognitive at the beginning here. Like, get your head on straight as a Christian, especially in light of the times in which you live in. And as you get your mind on straight, Peter says this. This is so anti-21st century culture. He says, above all, keep loving one another. The hardest word in that is the word keep. Because in order to keep doing something, it means you have to start at it. You've already got to be doing it in order to keep doing it. That's hard to do, isn't it? So let's ask that question. Like, are we really loving one another? Like, front and center, above all, it's front and center. Love one another. How we doing? Right, and this isn't like fanciful love or romantic love. The Greek word here is agape. It's the love of God. God's willful direction towards us as sinner people, as sinful people. God's willful direction towards us. So we say it this way. Love would be bringing your strength for the good of another, even if you get nothing in return. That's the kind of love that God's talking about. It's the kind of love that Peter's highlighting here. How are we doing at loving other people with that kind of love? That's very subjective, isn't it? So how would you measure that? How would you measure if we're doing it? I think that's what Peter is saying next. He says, because love, if you're doing it, it covers a multitude of sins. That even though we're guilty, we deserve punishment, we deserve the consequences, we deserve the challenges, the love of God covers those. The other word for that would be grace. Because the love that people experience from the church, pointing them to the grace of God or to the judgment of people. Peter is calling that out here. So that's my heart for us as a church. I want us to be a grace-based church. And what I mean by that is we're going to take sin very seriously, but we're not going to pretend like we don't have any. This has to be a safe place for those things to get worked through. It's so messy. It's so chaotic. It doesn't look fair. Sometimes it looks unjust. Sometimes it doesn't pan out the way we want it to. But if we're going to be a grace-based church, it's got to be rooted in the love of God. Because think about God's love for you when you were sinning. He wants the church to display that same kind of love. And that's so hard, right? So I want you to think about this picture of an infected splinter. My friends, that's grace. And that's going to come with all the childlike reflexes of like, ah, my finger hurts, I got a splinter. Here, let me get that out. No! Here, put it down here, hold still. And you get like a half an inch away and they're like, ah, it hurts. And you're like, I didn't touch it yet. Right? That's being a grace-based church. It's messy. It's gross. You don't want to touch that. You want to hide it away and protect it because it's so painful. But it has to come out. It has to come out so real healing can happen. That doesn't always look fair in human terms. But in God's eyes, that is holy and that is good. It wants to be a church like that. It's a little quote I found out about this, but there will always be a need in the church for forgiveness, both given and received due to the persistence of sin in the human heart. We are always going to need to be exercising forgiveness in God's love towards one another. And it's also been said, like, everybody loves the concept of forgiveness until you have something to forgive. Sometimes it's hard to let it go. Sometimes it's hard to have it pulled out. But that's what Peter's calling for as he's teaching us about this. So keep your head in the game. Keep loving one another. And then show hospitality to one another without grumbling. So think about hospitality for a minute. Like, when you hear that word, what comes to your mind? It might just be being nice, being pleasant. What Peter is talking about is something so different than what so many of us live. So hospitality in Bible times, hospitality in the first few centuries of life, it was not just a common courtesy. It was a cultural obligation. To the level that if you lived in a village or a town or a city and you didn't practice hospitality, people would then label your town or your city or your village, and they would say the locals there have bad character. Like, your level of hospitality was tied to how your character was viewed in those days. So this is like in those days when there's no Airbnb, no hotel chains, right? Like, when you left one village with your entourage and all of your cattle, and you're traveling and you stop in another village, you're completely dependent upon the hospitality of the people in that village to make a successful journey for where you're going. That was the way it was for many, many, many centuries. And so when you unpack this, there were four phases to hospitality. The first one would be invitation. So if somebody was traveling from one place to another and they landed in your village, it was your responsibility to go out before sunset to wherever the town center was, and you would look around for anybody that needed a place to stay. And it was your obligation to invite them in, to go meet them and say, hey, look, you got a lot of animals, you got a lot of stuff, do you guys need a place to stay for the night? And you would put that out there. Now, that sounds crazy to us, right? He's saying, just invite any old stranger over to your house? Kind of, right? But they would do it with a little bit of screening. So they would say, well, where are you coming from? Where's your destination? What are you doing? So it wasn't just blind. But then somebody would say, well, you know what? I'm a teacher, and I'm traveling from this village to the next one. They say, oh, well, you're a teacher? Well, right here in the square, why don't you teach us something? And it was expected that you would demonstrate your skills, or they would look for a letter of recommendation that you had to say, this person's worthy to receive hospitality. They would screen that, and then they would bring them in, and they would give them provision and protection, almost to the place of protection at all costs. You can even see some of the extreme, you know, wrongness of that being applied in some of the Old Testament stories as far as guarding a guest. But when you bring that guest in, you wash their feet, you give them the best provisions that you can possibly offer, you entertain them, you give them a place to stay, you even provide for their animals, and you're required to do it for at least 2 days. Right, 2 day max. That's a pretty good deal. Like, we can handle it for a couple of days. And we have some friends, you know, you probably heard the joke too. They say, what do fish and company have in common? Anybody know? Like, after 3 days, they both start to stink, right? That kind of thing. So it makes sense to have a couple of days, but the host could extend that if they wanted to. And then we would depart when it was time to leave. And as they were departing, you were expected to give them as much as you possibly could so that the rest of their journey to the next stop was successful. Like, these Christians in those days, they took this very seriously. They took this to heart. They took it so far to heart, there was actually a known charlatan in the second century that would go around and just prey on Christian hospitality and actually made himself really wealthy because Christians were so generous. The Emperor Julian in the fourth century, he tried to get the Roman state to model what Christians were doing as far as good works. You could even trace back the modern welfare society back to Christian hospitality roots. It's so big. And they did such a good job at this that what they were doing, I won't read the whole quote, but that what they were doing in caring for each other, it actually spilled out into the greater community, and the whole world was watching what the Christians were doing in regards to hospitality. Like, that's what Peter is calling out here. So when you look at that intensity of hospitality, that level of it, and he says, do that without grumbling. Right, I guess, you know, it's nighttime again. I guess we've got to go find some more people to bring into our house. I wish they'd just go away. Right? I can't believe they stayed so long. Right? Well, their feet look terrible, and I got to wash them. He says, just be hospitable. Do it without grumbling. So these are the hard questions that I have to ask as part of this message, but how are we doing as a church on that? How are we doing at the level of hospitality that Peter's calling out? That's a heavy one. Just sit with it for a second. Can I share with you some of the hardest criticism I've ever heard about church? And it was this. When we came to church, we felt very welcomed, but we didn't feel like we were wanted. That's hard to hear, isn't it? That's especially hard to hear because that was said recently about our church. We felt welcomed, not wanted. How are we doing? Peter's calling that out as a natural outflow of the love of God to show hospitality. So it doesn't happen by accident. As we said, this is about engaging. This is about being intentional. This is about raising the standard on that. So let me give you a challenge for the next month. All right? It's two words. In and out. Say it with me. In and out. I guess that's three words, but yeah. In, out, right? In and out, in and out. Okay, here's what I want to challenge you to do. Invite somebody you don't know yet into your house. Invite them over for dinner, some tea, some coffee, something. And then invite somebody you don't know out. In and out. Just practice hospitality. Invite somebody into your house and invite them out. Even if it's just to get a cup of water somewhere. But just seek to grow in this. Because that's what Peter is calling out the church for doing. The church was so good at it in the early days. So good at it in the early days. It had a huge impact on culture. Even to today. I'm going to recapture that a little bit. So keep your head in the game. Show love. Show hospitality. And along with that, if you have a gift from the Holy Spirit, use it. Do something with it. So you, when you come to Christ and you put your faith in him, the Holy Spirit is given to you as a deposit. And the Holy Spirit has the ability to give you gifts to do things that transcend your natural talents. Sometimes the gifts work alongside your talent. Sometimes they're completely opposite. But he gives you things. And Peter puts them into two categories for us here. Speaking gifts and serving gifts. Now, when we see speaking, we start thinking about preaching sermons. That's part of this, but what Peter's calling out in speaking is everything from speaking in tongues to prophecy. Anything that has to do with helping somebody understand the word of God on a deeper level. That is a gift that some people have. So lean into that if you have it. If you've got the gift of speaking, he says, speak like you're speaking on behalf of God. Now, of course, you're not writing new scripts or anything, but you're speaking with a level of Holy Spirit insight. Do that. And if you have the gift of serving, this is everything from collecting alms for the poor to waiting on tables to just generally ministering to anybody who has a need. If you've got the ability to serve, serve somebody. Wait on the table. Pray for them. All the things that go along with serving. And he gives us these two big categories. Now remember, the primary purpose of spiritual gifts is to build the church up so it becomes more effective in its ministry, more effective in what God has called it to do, and that's making disciples. So every Christian, I want you to hear this, every Christian can contribute to the body of Christ in some way. Every one of you, if you have the Holy Spirit, you can contribute. Now the challenge is this, we tend to reduce using spiritual gifts to a church service. Don't do that. You can use your spiritual gifts anywhere the Holy Spirit leads you. Take your gift and use it wherever you need to. We have tons of partner organizations that are always needing volunteers, always needing people to jump in and help out. There's places to serve all over the greater Akron area. Just give it an hour. Maybe make that part of in and out for what you do. But if you have something from the Holy Spirit, Peter says, don't sit back on it. Don't hide it away. Instead, engage in it and use it. Use it to bring God glory. That's part of living the rest of your life for the will of God. So, listen, friends, Peter's not mincing any words here, is he? Like this is so, like, boom to what he's saying. It's like right in our faces, so confronting and so challenging. He says, in light of what Jesus has done, in light of the state of the world, keep your head on straight. Live lives of love and hospitality and use the gifts of the Holy Spirit to make a difference today. So let's come back around to where we started. I shared with you guys that quote that Christians are succeeding at things that are pushing people away from Jesus. What if we weren't? So when you take these things that Peter is contrasting with life without God and life with God. Actually, life with God is on this side. Life without God is on that side for you guys. What if we took that seriously? And we really look at that. Now, we've been throwing it out in big general terms like, you know, the church and the Gentiles. But make it personal. Like, how am I doing in those two extremes? Where am I on those things? Because no one else can play the part for the church that you were meant to play. Because no one else is you. So put yourself in there. How's things trending? Where are you struggling? Where are you going? Like, are you growing in self-control, or are you sliding towards whatever your flesh wants in the moment? These aren't necessarily one-to-one, but it's one list to the other. We probably all have things on here where we're good on one side and not so good on the other. The goal of living for Jesus and living with the Holy Spirit is we close that gap. We move closer and closer to the things of the gospel. Peter called that in the beginning of the letter. He called that sanctification. Becoming more and more set apart for the will of God. So how are you doing at that? Because here's the point I want to drive home today. It's three words. Closeness creates change. Okay, I want you to say it with me. Closeness creates change. Okay, one more time. Closeness creates change. Whatever you choose to be closest to has the greatest influence on the way you do everything else. If that's sin, odds are you're going to do sinful things. If it's something of Christ, odds are you're going to do more of that. So I brought, I borrowed this from a friend of mine. So I brought some new tech today. Right? Maybe you guys have seen some of this before. This is what they call an overhead projector. So it's really fun. So as I get this set up, there was a story I heard about a guy. They were meeting in a church, and they had a guy that was a part of a drug thing back in the day and got one of his fingers blown off. So, like, you know, like they used to like take the words and like slide the words up, but he was missing a finger. So as he was changing the words anyway, but that's kind of fun. So I have all my fingers intact though. So I'm showing you this. So these are paper clips. Let's just call those paper clips people, okay? And let's call this ring. I got a ring on here. Let's call that ring you. It's kind of up there on the side, right? That ring in and of itself probably won't have much impact on these paper clips. However, you can take that ring and you can magnetize it to something. And once it's magnetized, whatever it's been closest to that's magnetizing it, once it's been magnetized and you send that into the fray, look at all that. Things just start to snap to it. That's what Peter's talking about. He's talking about being a magnetic influence in this life. That's the seat the church is supposed to play. That's the unique place that the church gets to do that. But if we're magnetized to the things that are on that sinful list, onto the things that aren't like Jesus, we're going to be causing those effects of those things that aren't like Jesus to continue. But the more we become like Christ, the more influence and more impact we can have, and other things get magnetized to Jesus as well. That's what he's trying to play out for us in this passage. He's trying to show you the level of influence that you could have in an insane time by simply living for Jesus. Living the rest of your life for the will of God. So here's how I'd like to wrap this up today. I'm going to give you one word of caution and two assignments. The word of caution is this. Don't forget that you were once lost too. Like, the longer we go in being Christians, the more risk we have of losing our compassion towards those who don't know Jesus. Recall what it was like for you when you didn't have the gospel. Those were some dark days. That was some serious craziness. But because of Jesus, your life is different. So as we talk about living the rest of your life for the will of God, don't lose your compassion for the lost. They don't know what you know yet. You get a chance to influence that. So the way you can influence that comes through two things. The first assignment is this. I want you to shift from judgment to curiosity. And you'll know it in your language, because here's judgment. You shouldn't do that. Or you should believe this. There's something else. That's judgment. Instead, switch to the curiosity part. It says, you know what? I wonder, how did you come to believe what you believe? Just a subtle shift in that question is going to make all the difference in their receptivity to the conversation. I can't believe you believe that. You shouldn't believe that. Or you can come at it and say, you know what? I wonder how you got there. Could you tell me? It just changes the way things work. So that first code there is a list of like 99 wondering questions that you can use in your conversations. So I encourage you to scan that, pull those out, take a look at those. The second one is we talked about spiritual gifts. That's a free spiritual gifts assessment that you can take. Just to give you a clue, like just taking the test doesn't guarantee that's your gift. Okay? It's just a starting place to begin to explore that. Because the Holy Spirit has put things inside of you that he wants you to do. And he gives you gifts at the appropriate time to pull those things off. So, don't lose your compassion for the lost. Shift from judgment to curiosity. Find out your gifts and put them into practice. It's everything Peter told us today in just 11 short verses. So along with that, keep your head on straight in these times, friends. Keep loving each other. Show hospitality. Put those gifts into practice. Because this is all for God's glory. Let's do that. Let me pray for you. Jesus, I'm reminded of some lyrics from a song I heard that says, where would we be without your love? And the answer to that is we'd still be lost in darkness. So Jesus, thank you for suffering to bring us to God. Now, if you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus and you want to start, you can just repeat this prayer. Jesus, I have gone my own way, and it hasn't gone well. I give my life to you, and I ask you to help me learn what it's like to live for your will. Prayed that. I'd love to catch up with you after service, give you some good next steps. Jesus, these words that you inspired Peter to write, they paint two really big extremes. And we live in the tension between those two. So, Holy Spirit, come. Sanctify us. Teach us to walk in step with you. That once again, the world would be surprised at how unique Christians are. So call us back to the core of our faith, Jesus. Give us courage to walk that out. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand together?
Grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. My feet may fail and fear surrounds me. You never fail and you won't start now. And I will call upon your name. Keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, you are mine. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would go.
deeper than my feet could ever wander. And my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. From Philippians 4:8 is your blessing. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace be with you. Have a blessed week this week, and we encourage you to invite friends for next week. Have a great day.